sent to you a year, in which I sat in committee, and every time everybody said, oh, we're going to like Clifton's suspension bridge after it's Brunel's greatest work, I sat and said, yes, but it wasn't designed by Brunel. In which actually nobody knew me for a minute. I then, about 2 years ago, was interviewed by Matthew Paris in Bristol, in which I repeated yet again that the Clifton suspension bridge was not designed by Brunel, and this time I came up with sort of chapter and verse. And Matthew Paris put it to the vote and said, who in the audience believes that Brunel did not design the Clifton suspension bridge? And almost nobody put their hands up at all. At which point I thought, I think maybe I better put my money where my mouth is and really get this sorted out. And I must say, it has been quite fun to do it. This is about my fourth iteration. I've given it twice in Bristol. I'm amazed I'm still alive. But as a colleague of mine on another radio programme, I was in saying, well, you know, Bristol would prefer to be the city of Brunel than the city of the slave trade. I did not say that. Somebody else said it, but I could say it. So I just thought I would get going. And as I say, this is about the fourth iteration. And as I've gone on writing it and rewriting it, I've actually learned more and more and more. I have no idea what the time is. I'm assuming when you all start crashing off your chairs asleep, that's the time I'll stop wondering. I've actually cut it quite a bit. I decided that you were all an educated audience, unlike the person who wrote Sarah Guthrie entry, who clearly didn't have a single solitary clue rooted what a suspension bridge was and how it differentiated from those sort of rig bridges that crossed spans in the Andes, etc., since time immemorial. So I left out most of that, but I have to put the first slide in because I knew Fred would be upset if I didn't. That is the first iron hanging bridge in Europe. And I'm putting it on. No, it is not a suspension bridge. And the reason
And Dr. Stark has never heard of this bridge either.
But you're taking us on a trip up the Tees to look at the bridges.
And it will be wonderful.
It will
be. Microphone, please.
Anyway. Oh, sorry, Simon.
Thank you.
Can everybody hear? Roughly. Anyway, this is not a suspension bridge. This is, in fact, a European version of all those rope bridges that was the only possible way you could cross immense spans in the Andes and the Himalayas and wherever, and which were known to travellers. As you can see, it has got chains running across it, and it's got the deck suspended on the chains below it. This one is 2 foot wide. There's one in China of about 1708 that's about 10 foot wide, but the fact is that your deck necessarily followed the curve of your underlying chains or ropes so that it wasn't flat. And not only that, it, of course, swayed like crazy so that you couldn't really take animals on it. You could take pedestrian. They were pedestrian bridges. And as you can see, you know, the unknown designer of this bridge has actually made an effort to restrain the lateral movement by putting in these side chains. Suspension bridges are, of course, a completely different kettle of fish, and am I going to do this right? Yes. And the modern suspension bridge was invented by James Finley in America. It's perfectly well documented. That's the first one in 1801, and this time the deck is hung from an overhead suspending system and it is not sitting on some swaying chain, so that in fact you could make the deck flat and you could actually make it quite stiff and you could put wheel traffic on it. This is the patent of 1801, as you can see, quite small, 70 feet, two spans of 70 feet. And actually, James Finley built about 40 of them. Here is a more famous one. Much bigger span. You can see it's, again, quite stiff. You could take vehicles over it. And it, Finlay and these bridges, inspired suspension bridge building in Europe, in fact, specifically in Britain. And this is the moment that I'm going to tell you we're only going to be looking at bridges of 300 foot span and more. There were lots of little bridges scattered about the country. But actually, I'm really only concerned with major league, long span, real road bridges. The point about suspension bridge development in Britain is that, of course, it came in the wake of the rather ambitious government-sponsored road programme, mostly led by Telford. So the Highland Road programme and, of course, the Holyhead Road to Ireland. And it was fine for a while, because traditional masonry bridges or single-span cast-iron bridges were absolutely fine, up to about 240-foot span. But once you get longer spans than that, this presents a real problem. And some other form of bridge was needed, and this is where the suspension bridge comes in. So news of Finlay's work arrived in Great Britain through some periodicals, but particularly through Thomas Pope's treatise on bridges, which is the first American treatise on bridges, and quite a lot of the engineers here, including Telford, owned the copy. And we know that Telford knew it, because actually he in a report on the Runcorn Bridge, which we'll come on to, he quotes Pope, who says, "Horses and carriages pass freely at speed without any perceptible motion of the floors over this bridge." So we know Telford knew all this. And of course, the thing about suspension bridges is that they're not compressive structures like arches, they are tension structures. And wrought iron was, of course, known to be strong to tension. This is, I mean, you're not a lay audience, so I don't have to show you lots of pretty pictures with churches being held together by wrought iron tie rods. Let that bit out, you all know that, don't you? Anyway, so wrought iron was known to be strong in tension. And the people who were in the forefront of the development were Thomas Telford and Samuel Brown. And they were in the forefront of finding developments to solve the long span bridge problem. So in 1811, Telford produces a design to cross the Menai Straits using a cast iron arch bridge of 500 foot span. And in order not to impede the navigation, he proposes to use wrought iron stays from which to suspend centering. Oh, I'm sorry, one thing, there we go. And it's thought by Roland Paxton in his wonderful paper on Menai Bridge that it, in Transactions of the Human Society, it is thought that actually this is what gave Telford the idea of suspending a deck. And of course the bridge wasn't built. Brown, more or less at the same time, is beginning to experiment with wrought iron for anchor chains and particularly for standard rigging. And he had a patent of 1808. And although the chain cables were taken up by the Admiralty, the standing rigging, which was made up of bar links, wasn't very successful, but it provided him with the idea of using these long pieces of wrought iron as suspension bridge chains. And he, in fact, does a prototype model in his workshop using flat bar chains, and you can see on the drawing the details. Quite a big span for the time, 105 feet, but it's only a model. And these ideas, both Brown's and Telford's, begin to come together on Telford's design for the Runcorn Bridge. 1814, I mean, Telford, as you know, from London Bridge design, had, you know, ideas of immense bridge spans. So this one has a central span of 1,000 feet. And actually, it was really the only way of spanning the Mersey at this point and keeping the river clear for navigation. You always have to remember there's a navigation element in here, and the Admiralty are always sniffing around. So Telford and Brown get going, and they carry out a lot of experiments in order to establish the tensile strength of wrought iron for bridges. And actually, this results in groundbreaking studies which lay the foundation for the strength of materials. This is the most important thing to remember, I'm a bookseller. There it is. That is the first edition of Barlow on the strength of materials, although he just puts in the iron as an appendix at the bottom. The later editions of Barlow get more and more iron and less timber. And there are a couple of pages of the experiments, and they're very rational, very well thought out experiments. And so this is the first British book on the strength of materials, and it contributes to the spread of information on wrought iron. In 1817, Samuel Brown patents his suspension bridge design using these long wrought iron links of either round or rectangular cross section, and the ends of them are drilled to form the eyes in which you put the connecting pins in so you keep the chains together. And in 1820, Brown's Union Bridge was built. And its importance can hardly be underestimated. This is the first long-span chain suspension bridge in Britain. It's the first suspension bridge designed specifically for wheeled traffic. It still exists, amazingly. It is the top bit, which is a sort of modern strengthener, but you can see there, actually he's using round bars, and there they're drilled and then the connecting pins through. It had 12 chains, two pairs of chains set on each side, consisting of three tiers each, round rods. Suspending rods were fastened alternatively to each row of chains at the joints. And that was the point about that, is that the weight of the bridge, the weight of the deck, is borne equally by all the chains. And it established the credibility of suspension bridges of large span in this country. And of course, as it opens in 1820, the Menai Suspension Bridge is beginning to be built. And of course, it's on the Holyhead Road, and this is the Menai Straits to Anglesey, and there is no way in the world you could have an arch bridge. You could, of course, have multiple arch bridge, except, of course, the Admiralty say you have to have clear space for navigation and 100-foot headroom. So finally, a suspension bridge is the only possible way of doing this. Actually, it's got two suspended roadways. It's got two suspended roadways, 16 links of five flat bar chains. Telford is using by now flat chains, not round chains. And so basically you've got two suspended decks side by side. And the design of the chains of the flat bars result in his 1814 tests. So between Menai and the Clifton design, there are four more long span suspension bridges. There's the Conway Bridge, very pretty stereoscope slide, just over my lower limit of 300 feet. Hammersmith, 400 feet. Montrose Bridge in Scotland. We'll be coming back to Montrose Bridge at some point. And the Scotswood Bridge over the Tyne, on my theory that a lecture is a sort of subset of the entertainment industry, that actually I like to show as many pretty pictures as possible, and this is actually one of the first part of my collection of engineering ephemera. So the Clifton Suspension Bridge scheme is actually part of the first generation of long span suspension bridges made of wrought iron chains. So that gives you the background to the bridge. And then you move into Bristol. Bristol's a very funny place. I mean, it was the second port in this country, and under it, even though it's 3 or 4 miles upstream from the River Avon, which debouches into the Severn. The Severn isn't much fun to navigate, neither is the Avon, because it's got the second highest rise of tide in the world, about 46 feet at springs and leaps, and actually really difficult, treacherous bits of water. So Bristol Bridge, Bristol was standing on the confluence of the Avon and the Froome. Bristol Bridge is about 4 miles or thereabouts upstream from the mouth of the Avon. And Bristol Bridge, which was built in the 14th century and was rebuilt by James Bridges and widened in 1768, remained the only crossing point of the Avon. There was no crossing of the River Avon downstream of Bristol Bridge until 1864 and the opening of Barlow Hawkshaw Suspension Bridge. I could get my little bit in there. It's really interesting, so that there's terrible congestion, as you can see, there's the medieval bridge, and there is the congestion. And it remained like that for, you know, well into the 19th century. And of course, that road goes to Keynsham and the A4 and down to Bath, which is, you know, and out to London. So it was a terrible bottleneck. But in 1754, there's a sort of beginning of a movement to build a bridge downstream of this extraordinary structure. And a Bristol merchant, William Vick, left £1,000 to be used for a bridge to span the gorge downstream. And he said, when the capital has grown to £10,000, this is the moment that you will be able to build the bridge. And he says in his will, I am of the opinion that the erecting of a stone bridge over the River Avon from Clifton Down in the county of Gloucester to the opposite side on Lee Down in the county of Somerset for carriages as well as horse and foot passengers and toll free would be a great public utility. The point about this sentence is the word carriages, because what William Vick is thinking about is not doing anything as common as taking, you know, pack horses and, you know, across to Somerset. He is thinking of the great Bristol merchants, of whom I have to say my family were one, living in great splendour down in downtown Bristol in Queen Square. And if you build a bridge across the Avon, way up at Durden Down, Clifton Down, which in those days was hardly populated, Clifton was a very young village at this point, it meant that gentlemen could cross the gorge and go onto the great ridge that runs between Lee Down as far as Clevedon. And very beautiful it is too. So it's a sort of leisure bridge, if I can put it so. So the word to remember was carriage trade. If you wanted to take your carriage and trundle off to the beauties of North Somerset, you had to use a ferry across the Avon, of which the most infamous by far is Roman Ferry. As you can see, there is some gentleman taking it across this really horrible stretch of water with the tides running in and out, great mud banks, very treacherous. And because I've been rather infatuated for a while with Roman Ferry, I thought I'd show you the other one. So there is, this is the hot wells, the gorge starts here, these buildings are still here. You know, quite tricky. So the first major design of a bridge to span the Avon is this rather extraordinary bridges. And actually, although it wasn't necessarily at the point where the Clifton Bridge now is, it nevertheless was going to be across the gorge somehow. And it's 200 feet high because, of course, you know, the Admiralty says you have to have headroom, don't you, for navigation of 100 foot. sort of wonder why there aren't any low-level bridges at this point. I mean, we're a bridge building world, a lot of exciting things going on in Ireland, etc. You sort of wonder, at least I, being Bristolian, why the hell do they build bridges downstream of the Bristol Bridge? To which that has to be part of the answer. There you can see the unbelievably muddy Avon. This is, and actually this is after Jessop's cut of 1709, so it's a bit more controlled, not much. It swings round here to, you know, central Bristol. You can see, anybody that knows Bristol now, sometimes there's rather nasty, muddy thing here, these immensely high banks, not much room on this side. On this side, probably your approaches were going to be far, far more expensive than your actual bridge. Nevertheless, having said that, he kept wondering, there were the odd efforts to bridge at a low level of hot wells. That's certainly one of them. Well, that's, of course, if that gets you your 100-foot span, doesn't it? The late, great, wonderful John James, who wrote all this up, said, very impractical design, he said. I've got laminated timber, the deck is hung from iron rods, and actually, when I inquired of a person far more expert on this than me, you know, how do we know it's Bristol apart from that you can sort of see the gorge? Actually, it was advertised in the monthly magazine for a drawbridge at Roman, so this is Roman Ferry, capable of admitting a West Indiaman of 80-foot mast, and it was submitted to the Bristol Port Company in 1805, and they clearly didn't do much about it. Then you get this one. This is at Hot Wells. This is at the low level, so the gorge opens out beyond here. Actually, this is a Samuel Brown design, just superimposed in this rather pretty picture on the Avon. Well, needless to say, it wasn't the one. However, you know, this is 1822. The time is getting ripe, and all of those things, and the war is over, and etc. Vic's legacy in 1829 reaches £8,000. And so the powers that be in Bristol decide to go for it. Well, they looked at the Menai, and so they advertise on the 1st of October 1829, they advertise for a suspension bridge. And the amount of drivel people say about, oh, it's Brunel's concept, which I said, no, it wasn't. They advertised for a suspension bridge design. And Brunel submits four designs. He's recuperating in Bristol, as I'm sure you all know, after that accident in the Thames Tunnel. He's sort of training about in Bristol, he's recuperating. And this competition gets advertised, so he settles down. And he produces four designs of spans between 720 and 1,000 foot, much longer than the Menai bridges we will discuss. And he was captivated by the drama of the landscape. And I was going to read you out yards of deathless prose of Brunel being captivated, but my guess is you probably, most of you all know that stuff. But here is one of them, not afraid, a very wonderful slide. But there is the 1,000-foot span, and you're looking downstream, and there is the cave. And what he wanted to do is to have you come out of the cave and into this great landscape. However, because his father, who is in London, and he, of course, is 22 or 3, he's very young, he sends his design for the 720-foot span to his father. His father replies on the 28th of October. This bridge competition was advertised on the 1st of October. The young Brunel produced all these designs, sends off the 720-foot span to his father, and replies on the 28th of October. So breathless. This has just turned up in Bristol, in the Brunel archive in Bristol. This is what he says, stone is cheap. Why not insist on a monument which would be met in paved structure? But actually, what his father writes to him personally, he says, "I'm charmed, dear Isambard, at what you sent me. But I cannot hide from you that a 720-foot span is a thing that I would prefer to leave to others rather than to do myself. A bridge with such a span would be rare and would not be stable because of never being level. The slightest expansion could do a lot of damage and the wind would make the crossing worrying for men and frightening for animals. I don't at all like the plane funneled up. I prefer chains on the same plane, 4 foot to 4.5 width if necessary, covering part of the walkway." Note that he's putting in inverted chains here to resist the lateral movement of the wind. Of course, he gets the navigation channel right, and I guess he was planning on digging out this side, jolly expensive bit of digging. And of course, the other thing about Mark Brunel, he actually had designed two small suspension bridges for the Ile de Bourbon bridge, each with a span of about 130 foot, and each with these inverted chains for that to restrain lateral movement. Anyway, as I'm sure you all know, the great Thomas Telford was called in to adjudicate this competition, of which Brunel had four designs, and turned the lot down. And he did, of course, then have to be asked to submit his own design, and I'm sure you're all very familiar with this. In 1830, the prospectus for the new bridge was issued, and in May 1830, the Enabling Act was passed, and a Telford design was part of the submission for the Act. But, as you can imagine, and I think we would all feel this ourselves, nobody much liked this design. And in October 1830, there was a second competition, and there were several credible designs, including one by Brown and one by James Meadows Rendell, who built the Montrose Bridge. And actually, there was a winning design that has long been lost by somebody called Smith and Hawkes. And in March 1831, the adjudicators make the choice to award the design to Smith and Hawkes, and that immediately that afternoon, Brunel goes to lobby Davis Gilbert, who is one of the adjudicators, and Gilbert goes to see the trustees and states to the trustees that he'd seen Mr. Brunel and that it gave him much pleasure to state that the explanations made by him had materially altered his views as to the details of the plans, which he was now satisfied were quite equal to those which he had originally placed first, and that considering the superiority of Mr. Brunel's design and the essential particular of strength, he should judge it preferable to any of the others, and so Brunel wins the competition. This is a kid of 23 with no experience of suspension bridge building, but tons of charisma and intelligence. He estimates the cost as being about 57,000, which is not much over the £50,000 thought by the committee to be about right. And here is the winning design by the wonderful Bristol painter Samuel Jackson. And the Egyptian style was chosen by Brunel as the most suitable architectural form for his bridge, so that you see these nice sphinxes up here, and sort of massive Egyptian-style pylons. However, Telford may have been tactfully disposed of, if I can so put it, but nevertheless, Brunel had to make some compromises to his design. Because the Menai Bridge was at the absolute outer reaches of the technological development in suspension bridge design at the time. And quite a lot of the Brunel biographers, including C.A. Noble, said, Telford, he was old, he was mean, and blah, blah, you can imagine. reasons for wishing to reduce the span, which is what really this was all about. He had huge problems on Menai during construction. There were 18-inch vertical undulations when the wind blew, and I'll be coming back to the wind. He feared that actually the problems of load and wind would increase with the length of the span, which was a perfectly reasonable thing to think at that time. And therefore, he insisted that the span be reduced. Brunel wanted 1,000 foot. He insisted that the span be reduced to 702 feet. And the way they reduced the span was that, is the great abutment on the leeward side. I pray you to remember the abutment. Also, he only wanted one chain. Partly, I think architecturally, he felt it would be better. But David Gilbert insisted on two. And the Menai had four chains plus two on each roadway, and Brunel is rather sniffy about the forest of chains. Well, you know, Telford had some good reason for doing it, and this is terrible, I did not put a portrait on, this is a terrible moment of nepotism comes in here, because my great-great-great-great-grandfather, the Reverend Sir Abraham Elton, performs the groundbreaking ceremony on the 20th of June, 1831, because of course he owned all the land on the other side of the suspension bridge on the North Somerset side, and naturally hoped that all these gentlemen who were going to come in their carriages and admire the beauty of our ridge would then come and spend a lot of money in Clifton. He also chaired the suspension bridge company, which is not such a good idea. Anyway, there's a letter from Brunel in the Bristol collection that says, I reserved a stone for Lady Elton, who made a little speech. Sir Abraham Elton then made a long speech. Of course, lauding me up to the skies, etc., etc. A quantity of champagne was then drunk. Well, I will say for my stuffy old great, 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 great grandfather, he actually did make a fantastic speech. And this is just a little bit of it, and it's reported in the Bristol Mercury in third person. So, he says in third person, he could anticipate the time when, as that gentleman of Brunel walked along the streets, or as he passed from city to city, the cry would be raised, there goes the man who reared that stupendous work, the ornament of Bristol and the wonder of the age. Well, I think he hoped he was going to justify his shareholding. But of course, at this point, they'd only managed to raise £30,000. This is 1831. It's the years of the Reform Bill. There is tremendous riots in Bristol. The Bishop's Palace is burned to the ground. Investors are very cautious. There's a lack of money. And the undertaking to build the bridge is temporarily abandoned. Well, you might think all was lost at this point, except that in 1833, Brunel in Bristol was appointed the engineer of the Great Western Railway. And of course, it was the Clifton Bridge that put his name on the map in Bristol. So finally, there he is. He's now running around the Great Western. But in 1836, the work starts. And the first stone of the Lee Woods abutment was laid by the Marquess of Northampton, who is there for the meeting of the Royal of the British Association for the Advancement of Science. This is, you know, much more fuss than my pathetic great-grandfather with his little breakfast ceremony. This is, you know, real serious stuff here. And I've done this chronology. I hate PowerPoint slides with bullet points, but actually, basically, as you all know, the Brunel Bridge wasn't built, and I don't want to go through all this because I'm dying to get on to the next bit. So basically, what you all need to know is that, you know, they go bankrupt, even though the tenders of the ironwork go out, the abutment is completed, the piers are completed, the anchorage chains are excavated, and then everything, then there is no money, and everything was stopped. And this highlight is actually my own, and it's the only thing that was left between 1851 and 1853 was this bar. And actually, what's left of the Clifton Suspension Bridge Trustees raised £142 for people wanting to go across it in a basket, a married couple who went across on their wedding day and got stuck in the basket. And there's a very nice piece in the Bristol Mercury that says, luckily they were released before their wedding night. Otherwise they would have spent the night in the basket admiring the views of the gorge. But finally, even that went. And of course, basically, the abutment ate up all the money. Brunel estimated its cost in 1831 to costing about £8,000, and in fact the cost was nearly £14,000. But actually, as I'm sure you all know, civil engineering costs, certainly then, I think to some extent even today, you know, ground conditions are the killer very often. It's a bit of a black art, and it was very black indeed back in 1831 and mostly wrong. There is the Egyptian detail. And interestingly, Brunel was intending to have cast iron plates on the towers. And the cast iron plates were going to be decorated with a series of figure subjects illustrating the whole work of constructing the bridge. And he and his brother-in-law also got as far as going to Merthyr Tydfil, and Horsley records that he made the drawings. Where are they? So that's what it was intended to look like. And those of you who know the bridge, of course, there, and we'll look at this later, there's a void here, which was, of course, going to be covered up by plates. And you can just see the sort of decorative scheme. So that's what it was going to look like. And that is, of course, how it ended up. And John Latimer, who's the editor of the very influential Bristol Mercury, loathed Brunel and went on loathing Brunel throughout the 19th century. And the only reason I put this mass looking across to Clifton, the only reason that this is again in it's a stereoscope, and as you can see at the top, it says Bristol's Folly. And there it sat, two unsightly piers, and you can imagine. You know, this being all covered up, the piers, when you look at them, are very rough. They're also different. The ones on the Clifton side have got voids in the sides because, of course, they were going to be covered up with metal plates. So it didn't really matter what the masonry looked like because it's always going to be concealed, wasn't it? So there we are. And this now brings us to what I think is the really exciting part, is Barbem and Hawkshaw. So the Clifton Suspension Bridge sits. People are grumpy, you know, they don't like it. What can you do? Brunel is monitored by the Great Western, you know, and other things, and the thing just sits there. And then in 1860, Sir John Hawkshaw is building the Charing Cross Railway and the Charing Cross Railway Bridge. And the Charing Cross Railway Bridge crosses the point of Brunel's rather successful 100-foot bridge built in 1841, a big span. And of course, when you look at the Charing Cross Bridge, there are, of course, still rather handsome Brunel brick piers. And this tower is actually very similar to some of the drawings in the Clifton Suspension Bridge competition where he's fiddling about with architectural styles. So Sir John Hawkshaw, they decide that the chains are coming through, and actually this would be a very cheap way of finally finishing the Clifton Suspension Bridge. And it had to be cheap because the Clifton Suspension Bridge was absolutely not seen by anybody as anything remotely like a commercial proposition. And it was jolly difficult to raise the money. And Hawkshaw and Barr in 1860 in order to raise the money, a private consortium from engineers and, you know, magnates, to raise the money to buy the chains and also to buy the pier, the Clifton suspension bridge piers from the pier from whoever owned it, it must have been Clifton suspension bridge trust even then. Actually, Brunel's lawyer, son Isambard, was on this committee. And by December of 1860, they'd in fact raised £30,000 privately of the estimated £45,000 they thought it would cost. And at this point, some of the Bristol investors now follow suit, which I'm glad to say my great-great-grandfather this time bought £10 worth of shares, no doubt for the same reason as his grandfather had, hoped it would bring Bristol burgers and spend lots of money in feed. And in fact, they say, while they're on Hawkshaw, that they wanted to complete the bridge partly as a monument to their friend Brunel, but at the same time, they want to remove a slur from the engineering talent of the country. So locally in Bristol, it's, Brunel. But the fact is, Barlow and Hawkshaw saw this rather prominent, rather ugly, unfinished bridge as a slur on the profession. So by the time they've got the money together, they get a new act in 1861, and off they go. And this was I decided would be really interesting. So this is the new bridge, and this is how it differs from Brunel's designs. This little section is what I call, these are the things you can see. Well, the first thing you can see is that Brunel's bridge was going to have two chains on each side, and Barlow and Hawkshaw decide on three. The main chains were not, as in the original design, brought down to deck level, but brought down, you know, to quite a little way above the deck level. The road is much wider, it's 10 feet wide, and so it's 20 feet wide against the original 16 feet, and the footways are now 5 foot 6 inches each, and of course the chains are in ward of the footbridge. So that's all new. That's the view of the full bridge. The backspans don't have hangers. Brunel wanted hangers because, of course, they look lovely architecturally, but you don't need backspans because actually this is all on rock, so that you're not actually having to hang the deck off your hangers because the deck is now sitting on a sort of nice solid foundation. So we then come on to Hungerford. Because, of course, the chains were taken from Hungerford, and actually, on Hungerford, Brunel did indeed use some elements of his Clifton suspension bridge design, of which probably the most elegant are the lugs. So there are the lugs. And there is the drawing of the lug for the Clifton suspension bridge drawings. Because actually it makes removal of single links easier because it's cramping the adjoining links together by grips over the shoulders of the lugs. I got this from Malcolm. If you need any explanations about the lugs, Malcolm will tell you. But they're very elegant. Hungerford again. Because this curious arrangement of the hangers, so that you get one hanger, there are two chains, you get one hanger hung off the joint, and then you get one hanger hung off mid-span. I mean, Pisley, who wrote this up for the book on Brunel, is very sniffy about this, and actually, Hawkshaw and Barlow both think that this arrangement of placing the hangers produces much too much strain at mid-span, and it risks bending the links. So they, in fact, revert to the Brown and Telford system of hanging one suspender from every third chain and only at the link joints, as you see. And perhaps, going back to this thing about Brunel did not design everything, the fact is these chains, these flat chains, apart from the lugs, are the classic Brown, Telford design of chains. He did not design the chains, he took their patented designs, very good, but did add these very elegant lugs. Well, the next thing you can see are the cats. Well, of course, any of you that know the Clifton Suspension Bridge, it's the cats that, of course, make the bridge very distinctive. You recognise the bridge by its cat, don't you? But, of course, the cats aren't Brunel at all. The cats were freshly, newly designed by Barlow and Hawkshaw. And, of course, they bow to Brunel's liking for Egyptian style, and so that it is rather sort of, they are massive and Egyptian in style, very plain, very handsome. And I've spent a lot of time whilst I was running around the bridge. There are a few swanky pictures that you couldn't get unless you were able to run around in a hard hat. But this very nice, elegant interior of these cast iron plates. So, as I say, the point about these caps is they're very distinctive. They aren't Brunel. So the next little bit is the less visible bits of the bridge. Well, clearly, I did a maiden effort, but naturally, saddles aren't very visible. This part, this thing, was allegedly this system in which, you know, you have the chains, was actually, this is Brunel's design from Hungerford, but actually Barlow and Hawkshaw add this rather elegant piece up here in order to take the third set of chains. And of course the saddles are set on rovers. Allegedly, according to Pugsley, the rovers were in fact designed by an artisan bar Brunel for the little Bourbon bridges. But I'm not saying I have not explored that. Pugsley says that. So there is, you know, the saddles, and the actual saddles, and there are the rovers. I mean, it's really fun to get up and look at this stuff. I mean, I think it is. And then you get the anchorage chambers. Well, I could bang on about the anchorage chambers, but it seemed easier to just lay it out. But the anchorage, this is very different to Brunel. So, this is new. The man saddles are also on rovers. They, for Barlow and Hawkshaw, splay the chains below the saddle. The back spans are at a much deeper angle, and each chain has got its own anchorage. And once upon a time, I went down and had a look at those some 30 years ago. So that's the suspension bridge. Those is what I would like to call the superficial part, because the real, real point about Barlow and Hawkshaw is the deck. And this is where we have to digress a bit, because this is where the whole problem of suspension bridges being incredibly unstable come in, and they're very unstable because they are incredibly susceptible to wind loading, and nobody understood it at the time. And so we're just going to stop for a minute for Clifton. We're now just going to backtrack a little bit and look at the development of the understanding of wind loading. This Breton chain here is Samuel Brown. And in 1833, its span here collapsed. Unfortunately, the collapse took place in the middle of the night. So nobody saw it, and everybody thought it had been struck by lightning. The point about wind loading at this point is that in the early days, Telford, Brown, Brunel, they were all concentrating on wrought iron and the chains and the hanging system, and they were very worried that actually the deck would prove too heavy for the wrought iron chains. They were worried about people rushing from one side to the other. They were worried about people loading. And after a bit, they became slightly worried about, you know, marching troops with some good reason, actually. In 1824-5, the Menai Bridge is under construction. And as it's under construction, it has to be modified. Because actually, Telford and Provis, his resident engineer, is incredibly worried because the chains are swinging in the wind. And so they in fact stiffen up the chains, and they tie the chains together across the breadth of the river using transverse ties, cast iron, all this is in Roman packs, this fantastic paper which you should all read. And so they sort of stitch the chains together in a kind of curious lacing effect, and I wish I could put a picture on it, but you'll have to imagine. It's like knitting, it's stitched together like shoelaces. So, again, Telford was right to be worried about the wind and Brunel's suspension bridge. And actually, Brunel's own report on the Clifton Bridge design circuit in 1829 is almost entirely about the strength of iron work and chains. So nobody is thinking about the deck. On the 23rd of January, 1836, this is Memory again. Memory at the time was seen as a great failure. Bear that in mind. A more than usually severe gale caused violent undulation of the platform. The gatekeeper described the extreme amount of rise and fall of the roadway to be not less than 16 feet. The greatest amount of motion being about halfway between the pyramids of the piers and the centre of the bridge. This is Provis writing. But Provis, of course, tells the dead time up. Provis and the Provis is present, and they go off and they interpret this great 16 foot wave business. But the superstructure is fine. So they just leave it, nothing is done. But in November 1836, so 6 or 8 months later, Brighton Chain Pier is damaged for the second time. And this time, the damage took place in daylight. And the action of the wind on the structure was described in considerable detail by a fantastic man who was my new hero, called William Reed. And William Reed, the Royal Engineer, publishes a paper in the Transactions of the Royal Engineers, and the drawings on the right are his. They're not very clear or wonderful, but nevertheless, doesn't that look like, you know, you can see. And he actually Reed was sent off to West Indies where he studied hurricanes, and in 1838 he produced a seminal book, An Attempt to Develop the Law of Storms by Means of Facts. And he was made a Horace for it in 1839. And so is William Reed is where the studies and the understanding of wind loading really begin. And then in 1838, so this is all within a short space of time, James Meadows Rendall, Montrose Bridge, it collapses under wind load. And this time, building on Reed, there is a real breakthrough. Because Colonel Pasley, who is on the Board of Trade and was the Royal Engineer and was a newbie, goes to see Montrose Bridge immediately after the storm. He gets in a coach and goes. And he concludes that all injuries that have ever occurred to the roadways of suspension bridges must have been caused by the violent action of the wind from below. And he gets this idea because he sees the ship shed roof at Chatham rising and falling due to wind uplift in 1836. James Meadows Rendall, the designer of this bridge, he says, in the anxiety to obtain a light roadway, mathematicians and even practical engineers had overlooked the fact that when lightness induces flexibility and consequently motion, the force of momentum was brought into action and its amount defied calculation. And he goes off to the Montrose Bridge, obviously. He reports that the superstructure is in very good shape, but only the deck is damaged. And he rebuilds the deck. And you can see it here. He rebuilds the deck using a complete system of vertical diagonal trussing, which was 10 feet deep, 5 feet above, and 5 feet below the platform, so as to ensure rigidity and to produce that solidity which was essential for for preventing undulation and oscillation. And in 1839, the Menai Bridge deck failed. One piece, this is called the bridge, one piece 175 feet long was hanging down and flapping in the wind. And Provis completely reconstructed the deck, 130 tons heavier than the old deck, and you know, and there's a lot of detail about longitudinal stiffening, blah, blah, blah. And of course, the bridge survives until Alexander McGill rebuilt it in the 1930s. Well, by this time, you know, suspension bridge engineers have been a bad time. An observation, Rendell says, observation leads me to conclude that the action of the wind was not uniform. For instance, it would act at the same moment on the upper side of one end of the roadway and on the lower side of the other end. In this case, unless the platform possessed a certain degree of rigidity, undulation was induced and oscillation ensued. Nothing but a construction of platform which made it in itself rigid by some mode of trussing could withstand this kind of action. Well, this is Brunel's original deck design for the Clifton Suspension Bridge. I think, judging from everything I have read to you, I think you will see that actually it really wouldn't have been very adequate, particularly not in Clifton, where there are incredibly strong winds. And of course, the other thing, they are beginning to understand the crucial role of the parapet. And in fact, Reed in 1837 formulates that the parapet absolutely have to be stiff. Well, that's a sort of pretty parapet, but it's not stiff, and it's in no way part of the structure. Great, my absolute favourite. which is, you know, commissioners report the application of armed railway structures in 1840, published in 1849, actually is rather sniffy about lattice girt bridges and says, oh, there's just half of them dismissed and half a line. No, they're not very important. But actually, of course, the lattice girt bridge was the railway bridge of the future. Hawkshaw, by 1851, had built quite a lot of lattice girt bridges and was a bit of an expert on them. And so, effectively, what this is effectively what you might call a lattice girt railway bridge. And as I was thinking, young man, I was thinking, gosh, perhaps they could have just built a lattice girt bridge and left off the chains. Though it was quite a crime, said to me last night, the structural system could very ugly bridge would have been, which probably would have been. But the point about this is, you know, whatever people may tell you about art, and somebody said, oh, well, you know, they were just sort of, you know, they modified. Somebody at some metro in Bristol said, oh, Barlow and Porter, they just modified the bridge. No, they bloody didn't. I mean, this design was not, would not have been known to Brunel in the 1830s. This is essentially a product of the railway age. And there you can see it. Actually, I think it's beautiful. But this is a part, this whole thing is a girder. There is the underside of the deck, you can see all this heavy trussing. And there is the opening. This is, you know, bear in mind that in Brunel's, if Brunel had covered it all up, you know, these boys up here would have, I know I've already said this, would have been covered over. Actually, I think voids make it very nice, those piers, because I think that actually, with just this opening, it would have been a bit sort of cramped, but, you know. So, at the time the bridge was opened, Barlow and Hawkshaw were absolutely given the credit and were absolutely seen as the engineers. There is the print that was produced in 1864 when it was opened, and there is the detail of it that says clearly, Barlow and Hawkshaw engineers. Lewis Wright was much, this is much the best guidebook. There were quite a lot of them. This is much the best guidebook of the Clifton Suspension Bridge. He, as you can see, gives them total credit. But Martin Beaumont, whose book I think you probably all know, which I've written in the biography of Hawkshaw, says that actually in the opening, Barlow and Hawkshaw were very badly treated, and although there was a toast struck to them, it was right at the end and everyone was leaving. And Hawkshaw was incredibly upset. The Brunel family, God, how I know the Brunel family, they had far too much credit was given to Barlow and Hawkshaw and didn't come to the opening. And this situation is somewhat compounded by the fact that the print sellers in Bristol recirculated the Brunel thing that you can see with the sphinxes. It does, you can just about see, say, designed by Barlow and Hawkshaw, but there are a lot of prints that were recirculated to the original Brunel design. And Steve Jones actually put me on to this. And I emailed back saying, oh, you're just another of those people who think it wasn't really Barlow and Hawkshaw at all. And he wrote back and said, no, I didn't think that at all. And actually, I then found a whole lot more prints, and I had to send them to him as a sort of, you know, ruffle. And so that the Barlow and Hawkshaw were incredibly proud of it. And that's very lovely in the minute book. It says, Mr. Hawkshaw, having expressed a wish to see the boat heads of the chains near the piers gilt, and the directors present agreeing that it would be a great improvement, resolved that the same be done to the extent of £230, and there they are, the gilded piers. I mean, you know, if I'd known this in 2006, I'd have pushed for them to gild the piers. So, fact and fiction. The sight, the span, the saddles on the top bit, the chains are all Brunel. whether they come, you know, they all come from apart from Sykes and Span, Sanderson, etc. The piers, I call them the undressed piers, are of course Brunel, but they naturally weren't meant to look like that. The cat, which as I say, makes the bridge so distinctive, a Barlow and Hawkshaw. Telford, at the beginning of all this, writes, Mr. Brunel's proposed bridge, though very pretty and ingenious, would most certainly tumble down in a high wind. Well, my contention would be, because actually Barley writes, gales from the northwest or southeast being nearly in the direction of the deep water of the River Avon at the place where the bridge is constructed, impinge upon the work with great violence, so much so that it is difficult at times to stand upon the railway. That's Brunel, that's Barley writing about 1864. Brunel's bridge would most certainly tumble down on a high wind. Well, I think given the problems with Menai, with Montrose, with the Brighton chain here, given the exposed site, given the fact that he didn't understand, maybe did, about wind loading at the time, I think the chances are that it would indeed have failed. But Brunel, who's only 24 or 5, would not have survived such a disaster, whereas Telford, when the Menai Bridge proved so difficult and had such problems, Telford was nearly at the end of his career. He did a huge amount of distinction. He died in 1834, and actually his career could weather the problems on the Menai, which, as I say, was seen as a failure at the time. I think the 24-year-old Brunel would have disappeared without trace. And to some extent, I think, as we will all know this, I think Brunel was really overreaching himself back in 1831. He says, oh, well, I've actually had some experience in suspension bridge design. Yes, his father's two little bridges for the Bourbon were the bridge 133-foot span, team. He went up to Sheffield to see them, and they had a trial erection in Sheffield before they were then dismantled and shipped out. So he had absolutely no experience in erecting suspension bridges for real, you know, real ground and real weather conditions. And I don't think it's any coincidence that the only first generation long span bridges which are still with us in their original form are the Union Bridge, the very first one of 1820, and Telford's Conway Bridge, because of course they're both in very sheltered conditions. And I think he was bloody lucky it wasn't built, but it put his name on the map and it got him the Great Western Railway job. I mean, is that all bad? And there it is. It is, I mean, I like it a whole lot more now. I know it isn't Brunel, I have to say. But it is a very beautiful bridge. As I say, I think these voids really make for piers. I love these caps. And in my view, and you're welcome to disagree, in my view, the element that makes this bridge Barlow and Hawkshaw is the deck. And I certainly go along with my great-great-great-great-grandfather saying it is the ornament of Bristol. It is. But actually, I think it's an ornament that's almost entirely due to Barlow and Hawkshaw, and it's the reason it still exists.